It's 3 p.m. I'm Jay Fidell on a given Wednesday. This is ThinkTech Asia. We have the honor again of having an informed international citizen, Russell Honma, and he's going to talk about the meeting between Xi Jinping and Donald Trump coming up next week. Russell, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Jay, for inviting me again for the ThinkTech Hawaii.
It's great to have you here, Russell. So, I mean, this is really important. We're in a swirling confluence of things that are happening around trade and multilateral and bilateral deals and trying to hold things together despite what the Trump administration likes to do, despite Brexit for that matter, and despite, you know, this sort of fold-in-on-yourself nationalism we got going. So there's going to be a meeting. Now, it hasn't been well publicized, but can you tell us about it?
Well, I can tell you a little bit about the history of, I know that it's scheduled for April 6th and 7th in Florida, in Mar-a-Lago, where Donald Trump, the president, likes to have his meeting with the state officials. Last time he met was Prime Minister from Japan, Abe Shinzo there. But I was told that through the limelight, you know, they haven't made an official statement through the State Department as a press release, or China's foreign ministry hasn't made an official statement as yet. But I heard that they're going to relocate the meeting location, El Palm County. It's in the same area in South Florida, but they're going to be relocating instead of having a Mar-a-Lago. But it is scheduled
Why would they relocate? Mar-a-Lago is a big deal, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so, but I think maybe it was incessant from the Chinese president, Xi Jinping, and maybe through their delegation. But I think from security point of view, I guess they wanted to change it to there. I guess they got to come up with the agenda of what the meeting's going to be. But through what I was told, they're going to want to talk mostly about the security issue with what's happening with North Korea. Because, as you know, China has influence with North Korea,
yes,
with Kim and Un and his faction. So
yes,
they want to restart the Six Nations security talks again.
Who's they?
I guess the United States, we want to push it as well with our allies they have with Japan and South Korea.
You think this is something that Tillerson talked about when he went to China?
Yeah, definitely. He went to Japan and South Korea and China, so hopefully they can revisit the issue of starting up the Six Nations security talks and complying with the United Nations security agreement for nuclear arms and missile for this.
Well, where is China on North Korea? I mean, it behooves them to be the one that kind of controls North Korea, and to be the one at the head of the pack in the Six Nations, don't you think?
Yeah,
they want to control things, and so it's they're not really in a hurry to represent Six Nations. Why are they doing this?
Actually, they had meetings in the past, but we tried to do one in 2012 in Beijing, China, but they postponed the meeting and never did materialize after that. So, but then the South Korea had, you know, meeting with the North in terms of unification committee, and they had their industrial park, Yangsing area, where they were, you know, they closed the industrial parks area and they have to reopen it again. So there's a lot of politicking going on between South and North Korea. So I think with the six-party talks, this includes China and Russia as well, with Japan, South Korea, United States, and North Korea. So there's six nations that's involved with the Korean Peninsula, and they want to make sure that they bring peace to the region.
Well,
and they don't,
you know, just 2 weeks ago, there was a meeting of the Pacific Forum, CSIS, the Center for Strategic and International Studies, you know, out of Washington, that met here. And, of course, Joseph Nye Jr. was one of the speakers, but the other was Admiral Harris. And when the conversation turned to North Korea, Admiral Harris said he was losing sleep over North Korea. We should all be losing sleep over Kim Jong-un. And that was a very threatening thing for the United States and for Hawaii. So, you know, I wonder exactly what the American position is on North Korea right now, because to Hawaii it's pretty threatening. We're within the ambit of their intercontinental missiles, and presumably they do have a bomb.
Mm-hmm.
So we should be concerned. In any event, he's concerned. Should we be concerned?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think when we had our Secretary of Defense, Mattis, he went over there and he discussed those terms with South Korea and Japan and with our allies there, since we have our military bases and we have a secured agreement as well. So I know that Admiral Harris, prior to his predecessor, Samuel Locksmere, when he was pushing for the peace treaty talks with the North Korea, you know, that kind of broke in the Six Nations security talks. So I know that Admiral Harris understands what the ramification of Asia-Pacific region is all about. So but that is our number one eyesore.
Number one issue.
Issue in the Asia Pacific region, how to work with North Korea and see if they can reason with them. And I know that we've been trying to do it from diplomacy and try to resolve some of the issues. But I think when this new administration with President Donald Trump, we're losing our patience. And I think when Defense Secretary General Mattis went there, he was a former Marine Corps general, so he understands the strategic ways of how Department of Defense operates.
Well, I hope so, because I mean, when this administration first started, first thing was Donald Trump taking a call from Taiwan and making negative statements about China and Xi Jinping. That did not get us off on a good start. And then, of course, he made some really negative statements about North Korea, which probably doesn't help much. So here we are, and it seems to me from what you've said that this meeting in Florida is really all about North Korea. It's about security. But at the same time, we have ruffled the feathers of China, and we have to sort of pick up sticks and resume a better relationship with them. And that's part of the challenge of this meeting, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. It's not only for North Korea issue, but I think what they're trying to do is come up with like putting all the eggs in one basket kind of approach and come up with other issues and make this U.S.-China summit more meaningful and see if we can come up with a better relationship, and not only for commerce and trade, but I think in terms of security, cyberspacing, intellectual property rights, some of these concerns that we have, and maybe hopefully we can create some manufacturing jobs to come to Hawaii, not Hawaii, but to the United States, and maybe they might have come up with a good economic package when they come in with
Well, you always want that,
exactly. I mean,
but sometimes it gets realized and sometimes it doesn't, you know, we don't have a lot of control over it. But, you know, the one thing I'm thinking is that, you know, this is a hard row to hoe right now between the U.S. and China. And, you know, do we have a stated policy? Does Rex Tillerson have a stated policy on how we're going to get back to, you know, a decent relationship? And, you know, is it, what about the TPP? What about, you know, trade agreements? The Chinese are trying to get ahead of us. They're trying to take advantage of the vacuum that was created when Trump said he was going to back out of the TPP. So how can we return to this kind of trade mentality that we had before?
Well, I think I mentioned that in the last talk host here about the TPP, when we withdraw from the, when there was an executive order when with the new administration coming in. And I think now what we're trying to do is trying to go with the bilateral status from country to country. But eventually we're going to have to go with multilateral or even trilateral kind of working with groups. So we got to justify who our allies are and who our partners are.
Yeah.
And I think that's what TPP was calling for, was we knew who our allies and partners are. So the 12 countries that signed that, the signatory members, they felt comfortable working with each other. So now, this recently, there was a meeting in TPP in Chile about 2 weeks ago, and China and South Korea and Colombia showed interest and joined in. So they were sitting in and with the 12 members. We had our representative from the USTR's office attend there as well and kind of oversee, even though we
met another party to it.
Exactly. Eventually, maybe in the future, we may have to join in with the TPP again, or even with RCEP, what China's pushing with the ASEAN Six Nations, trying to come up with a free trade area in Asia-Pacific region. So those kind of things are, you know, being discussed right now. There's a dialogue within the leaders.
Yeah. Well, let's refresh about our last conversation, because what I remember of it is that we backed out of the TPP, so that's going to hurt the TPP. And I'd like to ask you again how it looks like it will hurt the TPP. I mean, will the TPP survive without us? Second thing is, what will China do now that we've done that? What is their move? And the third thing, this is the more difficult, you alluded to it a minute ago, is you know, what can we do to counterbalance the fact that they, the Chinese, have this big advantage on us because of what we did with the TPP?
Well, I don't think they have a tremendous amount of advantage, because if you look at our bilateral trade agreement, still there's going to have to be a tariffs on non-tariffs and tariffs items. So it's obviously either you're going to pay import tax on certain items and vice versa. When we go into their country, will be paying for their tariffs as well. So you just all this is the free trade agreements makes the no tariff free trade with the no trade barriers whatsoever in terms of protectionist kind of movements. But I think in the United States' point of view, well, our economy is so huge that even in trade, we can still afford, you know, some of the tariffs that we've been paying, and we still think that we're making a bit of deal with the what the consumers are paying at the retail prices.
So, if you were there representing the United States in Florida at the meeting with Xi Jinping, what position would you take for the best result?
Yeah, I think we still got to work in a cordial, because we don't want to create any animosity or create some kind of friction with like a trade war or anything. Those we want to work with them, and we understand. If you look at the history of China, I remember when the first China premier that visited Hawaii was Yang Xing. This was in 1984, and he was the first premier to visit Hawaii, and he went to the East-West Center. Mm-hmm. And prior to that, he was one of the Mao Zedong's disciples with, so he's been understanding what the United States. If you look at Dao Xiaoping, there's two disciples, and Yang and Dao Xiaoping was the one that was learning from Mao Zedong. And when they were kind of when they were getting exposures to the West from the Communist Party, Dao Xiaoping came up and said, "Well, it doesn't matter what the color of the cat is, long as it catches mice." So it's like a slogan that we kind of say. So in other words, they're more open when it comes to business, and they want to, they want to be work together without being prejudiced.
There was a piece in the New York Times this morning about all of the criticisms, I shouldn't say criticism, insults is a better word, that Donald Trump has made to people in the press in this country, to politicians in this country, and to politicians and officials in Europe, and I suppose in Asia. And there were hundreds and hundreds of people who were on this list in the New York Times this morning. So the question is, winning by intimidation seems to be his brand. And, he does this freely. He continues to do it, even after it's obvious that on an international analysis that doesn't get you ahead, mm-hmm. may get you behind. Mm-hmm. Will, do you think that he has learned? Do you think that he will again insult people? Do you think he will again try to win by intimidating people? What would you advise him, Russell? Mm-hmm. What would you advise him to do now?
I would advise him to listen to his cabinet members. He's got a good cabinet members. Even the Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson, and his staff members are well-trained, and they know about the diplomacy and what channels to go through instead of, like his approach was in the beginning was fear motivates you. Yeah. You're motivated by fear.
Yeah.
So, but I think people catch on after a while and they want to work in a cordial way. And But that's the way, President Donald Trump, because, he's been a businessman. And I understand that, being a developer and working in the construction industry, you got to fill them out in order to cut costs. And then you try to come up with a better deal. I think he's
the art of the deal.
Exactly. But it works for him, and it's working right now, so you can't.
We're going to have the art of the break. This is the art of the break. We can take a one-minute break. We'll be right back. And we're going to talk about how this affects APEC. And how it affects Hawaii. Ooh, this mm-hmm. meeting is important. We'll be right.
I'm Ethan Allen, host of Likeable Science here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m., you'll have a chance to come and listen and learn from scientists around the world. Scientists who talk about their work in meaningful, easy-to-understand ways. And you'll come to appreciate science as a wonderful way of thinking, way of knowing about the world. You'll learn interesting facts, interesting ideas. You'll be stimulated to think more. Please come join us every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m. here on ThinkTech Hawaii for Likeable Science with me, your host, Ethan Allen.
Hi, I'm Nicole Alexander Enos, and I was born 3 weeks ago. Congratulations on being there for me for some of the few weeks of my life. I'm starting a new show, The Millennial Mind, every Wednesday at 2 p.m. for the month of April, where we'll go over some of the reasons why millennials are some of the most anxious and frustrated people at the moment. Ah!
Okay, did you see Nicole Enos on that? All right, here's one for Nicole. Wow, shout out. Okay, so, you know, you said there were 5 points to talk about and part of our of our program. So what are they that was discussed?
Well, I think, you know, when the back in early March, China National People's Congress had conducted a gathering. They meet once a month, once a year, and there's like 3,000 delegates from all over China, from different Congress, and they're officials, delegates, like just like we have a U.S. Congress.
Yeah, this
and,
is the big deal. This exactly, is where they develop policy exactly. for the country.
And they came up with 5 points that within the which they brought it to their officials, business leaders as well, with government officials. One of them was they wanted to increase their military spending up to 7.6% of China's GNP, which I guess they want to strengthen their position as well and go from that approach. Number two was the U.S.
Why does that trouble me? Never mind.
Yeah, and then number two was the U.S.-China summit that they're planning with Xi Jinping and Donald Trump. So
when is that?
Hopefully it's going to be scheduled for April 6th and 7th.
Oh, this is the one you're talking about.
Yeah, this is the one that we're talking
okay,
about right
okay.
now.
All right.
And the third approach, that China economy, because they want to be more open. They want to avoid the protectionist movement. And they see that they have roughly about 6.7 percentage of economic growth per year. So they want to project that growth up to year 2020. Hopefully they get it close to 6.7 or maybe 7% of economic growth every year.
Some people question whether those numbers are accurate. Do you think they're accurate?
But I guess they have their economists making their projection at their financial making within the fiscally and monetary policy, make sure they balance their state budget as well. So, and number four item is the issue on Hong Kong and Taiwan as one China policy. As you know, they have their one belt policy. So I know that Taiwan just had their election, and Carly Lam has won, and she's a local girl over there that was born and raised there. And you know, she's speaking from the what the Taiwanese want. You know, they want to become independent ever since Kam Chek-shek days, and how Taiwan was being, you know, so they want to be
days.
A sovereign nation. So, but I know the mainland central government people in China are kind of holding back, saying no, they're runaway progress. Now you got to be under one China policy. So when Miss Carly Lam called Donald Trump after the presidential election, you know, they were so concerned that she was trying to come to the U.S. for help for being independent. So I think Xi Jinping had to give a call to Donald saying that, hey, wait a minute, we've got this one China policy, so make sure they obey that. And so right now we have a policy to work with China as a one China policy. So jurisdiction between Taiwan, even Hong Kong is under China.
Sure, Hong Kong, Taiwan, it's
so
all in
the
protocol.
Basket there, you know, we have to go through that. And like in Hawaii, we have an economic consul from Taiwan here, but so they're not allowed to have an embassy yet. So we're using it as a consul for economic consul office there.
So these are the 5 points that came up at the People's Congress. Yeah.
Yeah. Another one was that they have to groom the young politicians. As you know, Xi Jinping and the premier, they have to mandatory retire by age of 68. So as they get older, you have to have another leader in place. So they want to make sure they get the right leader.
We should adopt that rule ourselves, don't you think?
Yeah, we have a two-term limit, but
we should have an age limit.
Exactly.
Ooh, there I went and said it. So anyway, you know, the thing about the People's Congress is you always wonder who's running it, because they all, you know, see, you've seen the pictures. Everybody sits there so dutiful. They stare straight ahead, and there's no banter or anything. And there's all these hundreds of people sitting in a big room. And you think that maybe the guy who's running the show, in this case Xi Jinping, was telling them everything they got to do and say. Is that true now? Do you feel that there's independent thought going on in the People's Congress, or is this just another expression of Xi Jinping?
I think you got to look at a chain of command. It's not only Xi Jinping, but there's other, you know, Chinese officials already that's been established, and they have their hierarchy within the time they spent, so they have their own factions already. But if you look at the demographic of China, they're so huge, and you know, you go to every province, they all speak the different language and the dialogue, so they make sure that Mandarin is their national language. And you know, some of them you go and they speak the different dialect, so you got to write in Chinese character to explain what you're explaining. So I think those kind of things, they have different culture there too, so you got to understand that one China policy doesn't really mean they're homogeneous.
So how would you characterize, you know, their place in the world these days? You know, I thought the train from China to Europe, I thought that was brilliant. They're doing soft power just the same way Joseph Nye likes to talk about soft power on the American side. They're doing soft power all over Southeast Asia and in Africa. They're making great progress. And their young people are getting out and they're, creating influence everywhere in the world. So you got to say that they're pretty smart about exercising world influence and developing, connections mm-hmm. everywhere. Mm-hmm. How do you think they're doing in general, though, in terms of world leadership right now?
I think they're, I think they're trying to strategize a way to make it more vision, so that they can actually get these projects, and even they invest into these kind of in terms of foreign investment. They want to go overseas, get themselves established, get a play ball with their politics over there, and start up the private sector business. Got to go there instead of being a privatization or state-owned enterprise going there and trying to do it. They got to get some of this private sector. You have like Jack Ma of Alibaba, and people like that.
Yeah.
You got to get more private sector people to go with the free thinkers
and
try to do it and be more innovative. It's a start. I think they're realizing how to work with the private sector now, let the private sector do their own thing and the government be the referee, just like our famous Adam Smith's of the invincible hands theory there.
there's also talk about how he's too tough and his missions against corruption and all that are really a facade for mm-hmm. knocking down his political enemies those who would bring him down. And I wonder how you feel about that. Is this something that demarks the times in China right now? Will they get over this, or will this be a problem for him and them going forward? He's trying to extend his term by another 5 years. Mm-hmm. He's trying to become a very powerful man. And you wonder if this is a good thing or not, and whether there's sort of a uplifting, younger generation that's coming in here that might, moderate what you might see as a tyrannical government. Yeah,
mm-hmm. I think what I've known from what I read, or I haven't met him personally, Xi Jinping, but I'd like to meet him someday. He's a conservative man. He's been educated in the U.S. He understands the global aspects, what China needs to do. Maybe he thought, corruption, one of them to straighten out the clean house in their parliament as well. And so I think that was a good start for him, and make sure that everybody in the cyberspacing that the U.S. was so concerned. So he came up with the joint task force to prevent cyberspacing, and mm-hmm. hopefully they can get into intellectual property rights and make sure that they be more innovative and they obey the international law.
And the rule of law.
So I think China's realizing that in order to accept the international community and be a global player, even when they became a member of the WTO, the World Trade Organization, they still had to obey some of the export regulation, like the dumping law, countervailing duty act. So they're realizing what the stake is all about.
Now, what about the South China Sea? What about the that island they're building? What about their refusal to accept the tribunal in The Hague?
Where does that
take them? If they want to be, respected internationally, that doesn't seem to take them in the right place. No? Mm-hmm.
I think they want to approach it like in bilateral, I think from a China's point of view, instead of having a third party decide, they're saying, let us decide with each countries. If you have a problem with Japan and the Senkaku Island, Daidu, or if we have a problem with Taiwan, they have a problem with Malaysia, Brunei, Singapore, and the territory dispute, they think it's, they're thinking that not the United States to barge in. They want to make their own negotiation with those East countries.
Isn't that ignoring international law?
Yeah, it's part of the, if you look at the, how you're going to map it in terms of the boundary, 9-9 of the dispute area
for the
freedom of navigation. That's under the United Nations Law of Sea.
Yeah.
It says that there is a boundary line that establishes.
If you could advise Xi Jinping on this now, what would you tell him?
I think I got to see it from you know, I understand what China's thinking is all about. So in, from an Asian perspective, I would like to see more like if they can work out the within the countries a dispute. And maybe those man-made islands that they had already built could be used as an international rescue center like the Red Cross. Yeah. And keep it more open in terms of due diligence and transparency so you have international visitors.
But would you tell them not to be a bully? Would you tell them that people consider them to be a bully when they do this and when they, you know, ignore international law and the United Nations?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, you got to obey the international, from an international perspective, from the community. They look at the rule of law,
yeah.
And so you got to justify those means. But China wants to work around, you know, indirectly, or they want to say, let us negotiate with each country that's affected.
Do you think that Donald Trump will tell him these things?
I hope so. I hope he can say that, or at least his staff member or the secretary, the State Department. I'm sure that we have our counter people working on it already, and make sure that the agenda is already there when we have those kind of meeting, and they understand what the ramifications going to be all about.
So another big question. We have a few minutes left here, and I always ask you how this all affects Hawaii, and what Hawaii could do about it. And we need to, you know, how international should we be thinking right now, mm-hmm. because of, you know, this meeting between the U.S. Mm-hmm. and China and mm-hmm. all the things you've talked about.
Oh, yeah, China, you know, Hawaii's a cornerstone of with China, with the relationship. If you look at the history, the first Chinese immigrants that came from China was in 1778, and they immigrated here, and they were the first Asians to come to Hawaii. So, you know, after that, you know, Chinese start coming in and helping with our plantation as well with the business and commerce, and by year of 1950, I would say we had like 46,000 Chinese Americans living in Hawaii already, and that's like close to 5% of the population. But if you look at all the mixed Chinese, we call them the Hawaiian Hakas.
Yeah.
There's roughly about 1/3 of the people that's in Hawaii are. Have a Chinese descendant or have Chinese cocoa.
So what should the government of Hawaii do, Russell? If you were the governor now, what would you say we got to do in order to take advantage of, or protect ourselves, whatever the case may be, in terms of these processes happening in Asia Pacific?
Well, I think, you know, what the government can do is basically we got to, from Hawaii's case, you know, China talks about the One China policy. Maybe we can go with the One Hawaii policy. And work with, you know, we live in Aloha State here, so we work with all different ethnic people, and we have we show the Aloha-ness. So
yeah.
I think that's a big asset for Hawaii.
I agree with you absolutely.
And we can apply American law here and do things with openness, with due diligence. So I think it's a great place to. That's why I wanted to make Hawaii the headquarters for TPP as well. Some of these
maybe someday you'll have your wish. Who knows? Yeah. Thank you, Russell. Russell Honma, wonderful to have you again.
Yeah, thank you,
Jay. Come down. I hope we'll talk to you again after this meeting in Florida.
Yeah.